you're here for Winning Strategies for a Successful Win-Back Campaign. We'll cover what that is and what it means to you. My name is Hank Hoffmeyer. I'm the digital marketing infotainer because I make marketing fun and successful. I also happen to be the senior manager of client solutions for Campaigner. If you need to talk about anything, an integration, a strategy, reach out to me and we'll definitely have a great discussion and I'll help you out the best I can and check out my content that's all over the internet. Today, I'm joined by Ryan. I'm going to let him introduce himself.
Good afternoon, everyone. I'm Ryan and I'm on the client success team at Campaigner. I'm also what we call a managed services specialist where I compose email campaigns, generate workflows, address deliverability issues and that sort of thing on behalf of clients. So sort of I have the role that you do, so to speak. Basically, I'm contracted to pretty much take care of everything under the sun and clients just log in and have a look at the reporting and, you know, discuss the results with me and we go from there.
Yeah, your role is very important because you help clients succeed and you're very knowledgeable. We appreciate you hopping on today to share some information.
You're welcome.
Let's cover what we're going to talk about today. So the first thing is we're going to talk about what is a win-back campaign. Maybe you know what a win-back campaign is, or maybe you don't. We'll cover that. Then we want to talk about some of the benefits, right? We want to make sure that you have the best possible engaged list of subscribers so that you know that your emails are getting opened and they're getting clicked on. And there's actually a huge benefit to doing these win-back campaigns that we're going to cover, so you're going to want to stay tuned. Then next, we want to talk about having a strategic plan and give you some assets and ideas to use in your win-back campaign, because you need to make sure that, number one, you're sending great emails, but then when you do a win-back campaign, that's your chance to actually save and convert clients or subscribers, you know, back into the fold and then maybe make some more conversions and have a better return on your investment. After all, you're paying for an email platform. You want to get the best possible return on that and make money off of your emails, right? And then we have our ultimate Q&A. This is one of the first times I think I've used this term, because we know there's always a lot of questions around this topic and we make sure that we answer those for you today and hop in and give you that information you're going to need, give you those strategies you need. And if it gets really in the weeds for you particularly, we'll take it offline and have more of a one-on-one discussion. Ryan or I can schedule a call with you and go over that. So we want to talk about what is a win-back campaign. But first, I want to tell you about a win-back that I had pretty recently. Before the pandemic, you know, I have a cat. His name's Tigger. We love Tigger to death, but he's always been kind of reclusive or humans. Never mind. I don't want to be near humans. But every now and then, he'd come by and be like, pet me or feed me or something like that, knocking water off the table or off the counter. Many people that have pets probably can definitely feel what I feel when it comes to that. But what I noticed, since I'm working from home more, I have a home office and I have a chair. It's a cozy little chair. Tigger's been spending time with me. He's been coming in, sleeping here during the day after his midnight hunts, and his belly's full. So he'll come in, he'll lay down. And every now and then he'll jump up on my desk and he'll say, pet me. Hey, I want some love. He gets in my lap and wants me to actually pet him. I feel like I want him back. I want his love back. But we're not here today to talk about how to win your pet's love. Well, that is important, and maybe that could be another webinar, but we want to talk about winning back your email subscribers. When it comes to win-back campaign, there's different names for this type of campaign, and you may have actually heard some of them. Maybe you signed up for today's webinar because you said, I don't know what a win-back campaign is, but then when I mentioned some of the other names that it can be called, you're going to say, yep, I know what that is, or you can impress your marketing friends by telling them the different names that this type of campaign has. So what we want to do first is we can call it a win-back campaign, which is the title of today's webinar. And that is going to be one option. The other option is going to be a re-engagement campaign. It's kind of like you calling a sandwich a hero or a sandwich or something like that. You know, you got Coke and then you got Pop, right? In different regions of the country, different regions of the world, they call things by different names. Another one for a win-back campaign can be called list hygiene. But what do each one of these mean? When we talk about win-back campaign, the focus is winning back subscribers that have fallen out of love with you, that don't want those daily pets, or they're not hungry, so they're not asking you for food. pretty much what they're doing is saying, your emails are irrelevant to me. They're not providing me value, or I just don't have time to read them. And it's your job to win them back and get them back into the fold. So the goal here is to get more opens, more clicks, and more importantly, more conversions, because that's what email marketing is all about, getting that conversion, making money, having someone book a call with you if you're a coach, or if you're B2B, you know, selling that big contract or something. So that's the most important thing for win-back campaign, is making sure that you keep people in the fold and you're converting them more. When we talk about a re-engagement campaign, it's pretty much the same as a win-back campaign, and your focus is to re-engage with your subscribers. So win-back and re-engagement pretty much mirror each other, just depends on what you want to call it. List hygiene probably is slightly different. List hygiene, similar to win back and re-engagement, but really the focus is to get people back into the fold and start engaging with your emails because, and we're going to cover this in detail later, it helps your email delivery. In other words, it will not go to the spam folder, but hopefully your emails go to the inbox. Why is that important? Because if somebody doesn't get an email in the inbox, they're not going to open it. They're not going to convert, right? Therefore, you want to have regular list hygiene. And a win back or re-engagement campaign helps you with that. Call it what you want, use whatever terminology you want, but just make sure that you're doing what we're talking about today. Ryan's gonna cover why we should care about win back campaigns.
Yeah, so Hank, touched on this, and it's very, very important to pay attention to your engagement levels. So pretty much the way delivery works is, and it depends on, sort of your focus, whether it's business to business or, business to consumer. But you're gonna run into situations where, Gmail, Yahoo, et cetera, they're paying very close attention to your spam complaints, level of engagements, the opens, the clicks that you're getting. And if they see that you're consistently getting, low returns on that, is pretty much, you run the risk of, your email just being relegated to junk, not just for that particular contact, but for anybody receiving your email for that matter. And then in the case of, business to business, you're looking more at things, like Spam House, Groupon, CloudMark, Outlook 365. So, if you're getting bad results, it's going to snowball. So this is something you definitely want to get in front of, in addition to, the other concerns that, that you're not converting. So a lot of the time, the idea, what people's first reaction in my experience is, oh, my opens and clicks have declined. I better send more email. That is not what you want to do. Right. It's just a case of diminishing returns. So at this point, you want to sort of, weed out the folks who aren't interacting. Because realistically, what they're doing is they're depressing your results, and it's just going to continue to get worse. I mean, if you clean your list too, you can maybe adjust your plan, save some money through us as well. Those are definitely all things that need to be taken into consideration, definitely. Yeah, so above and beyond that, it's a good opportunity, like this sort of situation, re-engagement campaigns, it's a good opportunity to reintroduce yourself. It's going to have a negative impact if you don't adjust. It's actually a lot cheaper to re-engage with inactive customers than actually acquire new ones, through paid searches, that sort of thing. It's definitely a money saver, and you already have Campaigner as a service, you're just utilizing it in a new fashion. And the other thing to consider, and it goes back to the delivery, is that it's very common for you to lose up to a quarter of your list each year. Email addresses are definitely disposable. You can get a new one anytime you want. And the other thing you can do with these kinds of campaigns is you can give people the opportunity to sort of let you know what they want to see from you. Like an example that I have is there's a national retailer who, I tend to buy clothing and things like that off them. And lately they've just been sending me everything under the sun, and it's getting to be too much. I'm thinking about marking it spam because it's just all kinds of stuff I don't want, but there's no opportunity in their email to actually select lists and what I'm interested in. So you can think about it from that perspective. You know, it's just at a certain point, if you're sending too much email, you're just going to overwhelm people and they're going to tune out.
Yeah, don't send emails just for the sake of sending emails. It needs to be of value to them as a marketer. It's not what you want to send. It's what your subscribers want to receive.
Exactly.
All right. So let's talk about scores and scoring. If I had to score my cat's love for me, it'd probably be pretty good right now, pretty high. In the past, it was pretty bad. When you send an email, the same thing happens. Good things happen to an email and bad things happen to an email. And what I like to do is correlate it to, say, a credit score. When good things happen, it raises your credit score. And when bad things happen, it lowers your credit score. So let's talk about some of the good things that happen. In the Q&A section, in the question section, what are some good things that happen to emails? I need you to make some commitments here and use the questions feature here. I bet you didn't think this was going to be interactive today. So go ahead and tell me some good things. I'm going to state the obvious. Open. Yep. Lloyd just said open. So we kind of said it at the same time. So we owe each other a drink. What are some other good things that happen? Maybe a click, right? Starring, marking is important. Here's another term to impress your marketing friends. TINS, T-I-N-S. This is not spam. If a subscriber goes into their spam folder and says, this is not spam, that is a high form of engagement, or it's a good thing that happens to an email. And it shows the email service provider that you actually want those emails. Replies, Brian, love that. Thank you. You know, generating more interest, Carlos. Yes, that's what you want to do with your emails and really have these good things that happen. What are some of the bad things that happen? One of them I'll mention is a spam complaint. What is something else that's negative that can happen? And there's one I'm looking for that almost no one ever gets. So we have spam complaint. We have unsubscribe, and then that's from Kilian, right? I think I said it right. And then Lloyd said spam. And then Christy said something that's close to what I always look for, delete without opening, or I call it ignoring. So Christy, congratulations. You actually kind of got the answer that I was looking for. So yeah, bad things, unsubscribe, bouncing, and then marking as spam. The most important one is people that ignore your emails, because what happens is the more and more people that ignore your emails, they are disengaged. So maybe you only have 40% of your subscribers that are engaged and 60% are not. That means your credit score is going to be bad. So when these negative things happen, it brings down your credit score. And when the good things happen, they go up. Why is that important? Because to make sure your emails are delivered to the inbox, you have to have a good credit score, which is actually called your domain reputation. Every time you send an email, those good and bad things happen, affect your domain reputation. But like I said, I like to think of it as a credit score. And that's what you need to pay attention to. And that's why win-back campaigns are important. Active subscribers means higher engagement rates, more opens, more clicks, more replies, all those good things. Low engagement rates mean your emails are going to go to spam more. And then you want to make sure that you have that highest sending reputation you could possibly have. And that's what I just said. Send emails that your subscribers want, not what you want to send as a marketer. Yeah. And then you get more inboxing, you have more engagement, and more importantly, you're making more money.
Yeah, we got a question from Sid. He says, what's a good open rate? It's going to vary from industry to industry. Typically, say, just to give you a rough idea, though, if you're a web sign up for a campaign or account, and you're in sort of our, you know, generic pool of, you know, good behavior, I guess you could say, we want to see at least in the neighborhood of 10 to 15%. But it can be tougher in some industries, and then, you know, easier as well. Like if you're, you know, sending a newsletter to your church group, it's probably going to be a pretty high open rate. Right. But if it's more of a retail end of things, you know, might be a bit tougher. And it's, you know, generally you want to see it to be relatively constant, but it's gonna fluctuate, and you know, sometimes you'll have some hiccups along the way. But that's what your client success representative or your account manager or the support team is there to help you with. So I encourage you to reach out to us.
Sid, you can go to smartinsights.com and from that website search for industry email marketing industry analytics or something like that, or close, you're going to get what you need. And it breaks it down by industry. So if you're a nonprofit, it tells you. If you're a manufacturer, it's going to tell you. If you're retail, it's a great resource. Ryan mentioned, you know, what an overall average good open rate is, you know, 15, 10, you know, 20%. And it, like, again, it depends on your industry. So go take a look at smartinsights.com.
Yeah. One quick recommendation I would make if, you know, if you're concerned about your open rates, is, and especially if you're, you know, you're dealing with consumers, is in the campaign reporting. You want to look at the top domains report. This is going to break down your results by the domain, you know, by Gmail, by Yahoo, by AOL. And a lot of the time, if you're having a problem, it might just be with one domain. Then at which point, you know, there's constructive measures you can take, like targeting what we would call the positive interactors, the openers, the clickers, etc. And then you want to suppress, the poor results, so that it'll increase your overall reputation with that particular domain. We can look at, you can request mitigation from that particular domain as well. But it's a real concern, especially with something like Gmail, which is such a large segment, the email marketplace.
Right. And that's why Ryan and I have jobs, because we help with information like this, and we love to help clients make sure they get the best possible return on investment with their campaigns. So let's talk about a strategic plan. Ryan's going to go over that.
So pretty much, there's factors you want to focus on. The main thing is, what are we considering inactive? What are we looking for? And it's going to vary depending on, what you want to do. I'm actually going to display a few more of these because they're kind of interrelated. So what do you consider inactive? So, what you're looking at in terms of success for the campaign is, say opens. I recommend you at least look at, the last 6 months. I mean, if you go too far back at like 2 years, you're not really going to accomplish a lot in terms of eliminating unengaged contacts. The other thing would be is like, are you more concerned about conversions? In which case, you want to think about, how long, it is since someone purchased, that kind of scenario. So, it kind of depends on how you would define that. And, your business better than we do, and, what those answers are. But say for, purchase, 3 months of, purchasing would be, they're at risk of lapsing. 6 to 9 months, they're in the process of doing so. In 9 months, they pretty much lapsed. So, and they're not engaged with your business or your brand. So it really revolves around, the segment. We don't want to get in the weeds on the segmentation. Again, this is where your account manager, your client success rep, or the support team can help you out in developing the appropriate segmentation to do the targeting. But yeah, you want to think carefully about what your goal is and how aggressive you want to be. 6 months is sort of the minimum I would recommend, but you could be more aggressive, and it might be appropriate depending on what it is that you're doing. And particularly so if you're in sort of dire straits in terms of, your opens have bottomed out, you may want to be more aggressive. It's pretty situational, so there's no real cookie cutter answers, but that's what the team, our team's here for.
Right. I think more gold stars go to those that are a little bit more aggressive. I always applaud those that kind of get rid of the disengaged folks quicker, because it's like ripping the Band-Aid off rather than saying, well, maybe they'll come back and buy from me. I'd rather see you remove them.
Yeah, it's sometimes it's better just, like Hank says, get it over with. and then the other consideration you want to make is, how many times do you want to touch base with users? Again, it may be situational depending on your industry, but generally speaking, most people tend to do around 3 campaigns, maybe 4. Especially if you're in a situation where, you're struggling with delivery, sending more email might be detrimental. So again, you just kind of want to pull the Band-Aid off. And then the final consideration is, what are you going to do with the people that you've identified that aren't engaged and, don't plan to engage? So, again, it's situational. You could just sort of, figure out who they are and bulk unsubscribe them. The consideration there would be that, if they do engage at some point later on, you might need to resubscribe them. So you could shuffle them into, a suppression list or something of that nature, and use a segment. So, give me everybody in list A, but not in list B. And then, that way, if they do engage, you can work them back into the mix.
All right. So let's talk about what it takes to get started.
So you're going to basically create your segments. That's the first piece of the piece of the puzzle, and that, you know, you need to generate the targeting. Again, it's going to be situational depending on what you want to do. Then you're going to want to set up your workflows, also known as drip marketing. So basically it's an automation feature in Campaigner, where you have a toolkit, you know, you have a trigger, a campaign. Generally you put in, you know, next it would be a segment, basically to check on the behavior, another campaign. Then you would have another segment to see whether they opened or not. And then another check, last campaign, and then you decide what to do with them. So, you know, once you have all the pieces of the puzzle in place, you're going to activate it. And then we're on to, you know, say, you know, what we're going to do with, you know, the folks who don't engage. Now, if you don't have workflows in your Campaigner account, that's not to say you can't engage in a re-engagement campaign. This is all absolutely doable with just, you know, the, you know, a standard account. It would just be more of generating the campaigns and scheduling them manually, but segmentation won't be any different. And again, you know, you can reach out to, you know, your client success rep, the support team, you know, to give you some guidance on that. But in general, you know, we're in a situation here where we're not engaged. So you kind of want to step outside of your regular game plan or shtick or whatever you want to call it. You want to get people's attention. So, you know, where do you do that? Subject line. So you're going to want to basically get people's attention with it to get them engaged so that you stand out in the inbox. Now, you know, I would recommend getting creative. Sort of anecdotal information is that, you know, won't go into candidates, whatever, but, you know, former president in the US, his team actually, you know, did some pretty off the wall subject lines, and their fundraising went through the roof and they got people engaged. So be creative. And we do have experiments, AKA A/B split testing as well, for you to play with.
Awesome. So let's talk about some strategy outlines. And this is going to be kind of like a blueprint right here. Now, I don't want you to be taking notes on this holistically, because we're going to cover it a little bit more in detail, and there's probably a better graphic that's going to show you what's happening. But I want you to get in the mindset of having the strategy and running your campaigns. So the first thing is you're going to identify those inactive recipients, and that's through segmentation, like Ryan told us. Maybe, you know, if you send every week, what you want to do is look at people who haven't opened in 6 months. If you send once a month, look at people who haven't opened in a year, or whatever works for you. And then Lloyd, we're going to get to your question too, because it depends on your industry as well. But once you identify those recipients, what you're going to want to do is have them enter into a segment or qualify for a segment. So if you set up a segment that says, show me anyone who has not opened an email in the last 6 months, every time they meet that criteria, they will be in that segment. Then what you can do is send them that "we miss you" email, or "are we breaking up?" Because if somebody's breaking up with me, I don't know about you, but I'm going to open that email to find out why. And in that email, you're going to ask them if they still want to be part of your newsletter, get your emails, et cetera, and come back. Or maybe they do want to be removed, right? So then you're going to wait. Maybe it's 7 days after you send that first email, and you're going to look at people who either unopened or click or did or did not do something with it. So what I would do is, if they did not open that email, send a follow-up email. And that's, here's the divorce papers, right? Because, you know, we're breaking up. Here's the divorce papers. We noticed that you haven't opened our first email or any of our other emails in 6 months. So here are the papers, but we just want to give you one last try. And if you don't want to sign these papers, stay with us, and that's fine. And then again, wait 7 more days and then send that final email. It's done. It's over. Signed, sealed, delivered. Here are the papers. We're done. And then what you want to do is actually remove them from your list, or put them into a suppression list, like Ryan said. But, you know, all along the way, you're going to look at folks, maybe folks that engaged. I like this part, right? So along the way, if somebody actually does engage with that email, send them, you know, the welcome back email. Hey, we're glad to have you back. Here's 12 or a dozen roses, et cetera. We love you again. We're glad you fell back in love with us, et cetera. I know I'm being cheesy, but whatever you want, I'm trying to get you to think outside the box here. Then you just keep them or move them back to a normal list. There's so many different ways to do that, but this is kind of one way. So the step one is to trigger the automation of your campaign, right? So if you're using workflows, this is what you could do. You could trigger, you know, a workflow. Now, Ryan mentioned maybe you don't have workflows in your account, or maybe you're using a different ESP and you don't have workflows or automation. You can manually do this. You can identify people through segmentation, or even just add people to a list that haven't engaged, and then just send them an email and then wait and see who didn't open, you know, make that a list or a segment and then send another email. But why would you do that if you can use automation? That's why we always talk about that. But what you're going to do is, you know, you're going to set up those workflows with those, say, three emails. So I say three and done. You got those all set up. So once somebody meets the behavioral filter of not opening, that's where they get entered in. Of not opening for 6 months, they get entered in. But then you got that first email. You send that. Then you're going to wait 7 days and check who didn't open the first email. Then you're going to wait 7 more days and see who didn't open the first two, then send the last one. So you have your checks and balances, and with automation or workflows, that automatically happens for you. So what we'll do is send that first message. We miss you. We want you back. You know, maybe give them an opportunity to get a discount if they come back. Maybe it's 10% off, 20% off. What does a client or customer mean to you? I'll let you decide that. You know, the second one's please come back. You know, again, special coupon or updates. Maybe you want to have that coupon in that second email. Could be in your first. Depends on the type of business you're doing and how many emails you're running, right? Then you have number three, is this goodbye? And then that's where you actually go ahead and remove them. Keep in mind that 45% of customers who receive win-back emails read subsequent messages. So it is worth doing these campaigns, because normally the folks that engage with those say, I do want to have a relationship with them moving forward. Let me get back into the fold. And then they start interacting with further emails from you. With workflows, I mentioned this, it's like setting it up once. You don't need to do anything else. You don't have to do all that manual work. And you can automatically remove people from a list or from your account if they don't engage. That's the beauty of using workflows. So you have message one, check to see if they opened or didn't open. And then from there, we'll update the contact accordingly. After 7 days, send another email, check to see if they opened or did not open. Again, the third email, and again, this is only the people that didn't open one or two, they're gonna get this final one. And then after 7 to 14 days or whatever, 21 days, whatever you wanna do, go ahead and just mark them inactive, remove them. As I said, rip that Band-Aid off. It's positive to do that. The beauty here, folks, is you can add them back. I know you're marketers. I know you don't wanna say goodbye. I know sometimes you have to report numbers. We have 200,000 email subscribers, but if only 10,000 are opening, what does that number actually mean? I'd rather say, I have 50,000 email subscribers and 80% of them are highly engaged. I'd rather have those metrics all day long. So don't look at the number of total subscribers. Look at the percentage of active subscribers you have. And when you're saying goodbye, just remember, if there's no engagement, they're probably not going to engage in the future. There's brands that got in trouble doing this in the past where they just kept getting people, well, we want our brand in front of them in the inbox. Maybe they see our emails, but they're not opening them. And at some point, they're going to need something from us. I would not count on that, because what is it doing? It's hurting your email deliverability. Do you have something to add there, Ryan?
Oh, yeah. I mean, I was just going to reiterate your point, essentially, that, you know, if your folder, or excuse me, if your email is just going to the spam folder, or being filtered out outright and not even making it to the spam folder, say in like a, you know, like 365 situation or something like that, you're not doing yourself any good. You're harming yourself for no benefit. They need to go.
And you kind of reminded me of something I do. And looking at this reminder section over here, you know, if you're continuing to send people that have not engaged with your emails, opened an email or clicked on a link in your email, you're hurting yourself, right? Because number one, your metrics aren't going to be correct. Number two, it's going to hurt your sender reputation, your domain reputation. There's certain emails I get that I always feel like I want to unsubscribe, but I'm like, well, maybe one day I'll want to go back and read these, or I'll read the next one. And I just ignore it. I think I'm actually doing more harm to the sender by not unsubscribing, because I'm never going to convert, you know, hardly read the emails, but I feel bad for them because I know they're trying to send good content to me. But they should identify that I have not opened an email in a while or engaged with the email and try to get me off the list is really what they should be doing.
Yeah, I mean, this is conjecture because they don't publish this stuff, but you know, some people think that Gmail, after they use AI to screen their email, that if you haven't opened someone's email after, you know, 6 sends, that there's a good chance you're going to the spam folder, and then you continue down that route, that might be applied across the board, right, particularly if you have complaints. So, yeah, something to be very concerned about, for sure.
So now we talked about kind of strategy and what a win-back campaign is. This is my favorite part, looking at some example emails from brands that we know and some may love, et cetera, and then some other tips in here. So let's take a look at some examples. I'm going to bring all three of these up. And for me, my favorite one is the one in the middle. Folks, in the questions, let us know which one you like the most by looking at these. I'm going to ask Ryan what his is in a minute, but mine's the one in the middle, because not only do they have a stuffed animal, they have a real animal in the email here. And what they're saying is they miss you, and they just have this sad dog, you know, on top of his favorite pet, right? And it's from Kaijin, and they're trying to get you back in. They're going to give you a 10% off coupon if you come back. So they have an offer. They're using cute imagery, and I love how they have the big "we miss you" at the top here, and it's a great example of what to do. Ryan, which one is your favorite?
I would agree with you that I liked it, the "we miss you" one, because it's doing a number of things. It's acknowledging that they're paying attention to you as a consumer, like of their product, that the interaction isn't there. There's an offer, promo code, to entice you to get engaged. And there's a bit of a sense of urgency as well. And regardless of what form your email takes, I would recommend that. It's the fear of missing out. You want to get people a reason, to get engaged. And here, it's kind of hitting a lot of the things I'd like to see. Plus, they're offering free shipping with a purchase of over $100. So there's a bunch of incentives. to get involved.
The one on the left is from Rulala. That one's kind of like the third email you would send. That would be the, here are the papers, signed, sealed, delivered. It's kind of the last chance. And they're just expressing that. And they're saying, we hate goodbyes. Everybody hates goodbyes that are kind of playing into your psyche there. Image of people. And then you could say, keep the emails coming by clicking on the link there. And then we have Chipotle. They're giving you an option, stay in or stay out. So if you open your email and say, oh, they're trying to win me back, you have options here. You can say, hey, I want to stay in, and I love burritos. Or no, I'm lactose intolerant, and I really love the sour cream, but I just can't handle it. I don't know what it would be, but that one's a pretty good example.
The one thing they do all have in common that I like is they're kind of quirky and attention grabbing. This is not the time to be boring, would be the point.
Right. Don't be afraid to play into emotions, folks, because emotions are powerful, and it's what drives us sometimes to actually make decisions. So when we look at these two, the one from Teespring and the one from Savory Spice, that's the first thing you get is that feeling of emotion. Oh my God, look at a cute little puppy, or the sad emoji on the right hand side. They're trying to get you to feel sad or get interested in learning why they sent that email and want you to stay in the fold. It's very powerful to delve into and use emotional type of content. And it was Lloyd and Scott that said they love the middle one on the last page. So everyone agreed that one was probably the best one on that slide. Yeah. This one, I'm torn. I don't know which one I like the best.
I like the Teespring one the best. I'm sort of a practical person by nature, and it's telling you flat out is that you sold 214 products for this amount of money, you had a good success rate, why don't you do it again? It's reminding the client or the customer why they were using you in the first place. It's like, hey, you made a bunch of money, you should come back and do it again. That's pretty persuasive in my opinion.
And that's the power of when you're collecting data from, say, a shopping cart platform, or just in general, you have it, using it in an actual email, because every person is going to have different content in there, and that's powerful. It's kind of like you have a relationship with them. Hey, you've done this with us in the past, and you're no longer doing these things. We want you to come back. So I'm glad you pointed that out, Ryan, because it's important to try to, quote unquote, personalize the emails as much as possible. But I guess the marketer in me likes the one on the right, because it's kind of like artistic, and it's an emoji where, I guess I use emoji too much in social media. Maybe that's why I lean towards that, because Lloyd is saying he likes the dog one as well. So really, it just depends on you. It also depends on your brand and what you want to do, right?
Yeah, agreed.
Let's look at some more. I'm going to bring them all up here. Urban Outfitters is trying to have fun, and they're trying to make it look like a chat session. Starbucks on the right is very simple. Just come back. We miss you. They want to give you a discount. I like the Animoto's. Kind of looks like it's a letter mailed to you. And then there's Nordstrom, they're asking if you want fewer emails, which is another thing. It's like a preferences campaign. Hey, are we sending you too many emails? Maybe we could send you less if you stay in tune with us. These are very good examples.
I like the Nordstrom and the Animoto ones for that reason. I touched on it earlier, but, you know, with the, you know, sort of anecdote about the retailers just sending me too much stuff. Like, I like, you know, the things that I'm purchasing off you, but you're sending me stuff that I just have no interest in. And then, you know, then I start ignoring their emails because, oh, it's just, you know, things that I don't buy, you know.
Right.
So I sort of more treat it as, well, I'm just going to go to, you know, the webpage and just shop from there, as opposed to really, you know, leveraging, you know, any deals that I'm interested in. But, you know, the result is the same, is that I'm not opening their emails, which, you know, looks bad to Gmail, which I use, you know, for my personal email.
Right.
So it's by allowing, if they would allow me to say, I just want emails about men's clothing or something like that, and I want to skip all the, you know, the household goods and whatnot, they're not really doing themselves any favors, right. I guess you could say.
Yeah, there's a webinar that I did in the past where we talk about sign up forms and asking people what kind of emails they want, so that you can, you know, send them the types of emails they want. Like, say you have a sale email and then you have a newsletter. Maybe if somebody wants one and not the other, but you're sending both. And Lloyd said he likes the Nordstrom one, and it's not a shocker, because he was asking, hey, what frequency should I be sending emails? And, you know, yeah. I already see that you're saying you like this one because you want to know what they want to get, which is good. So measuring is good.
Yeah.
And Urban Outfitters, what they're doing something here I love, and I've seen it done better in the past. It's like, hey, maybe email's not your thing, but maybe social is. Hey, if you don't want our emails, follow us on social media. So maybe you lose them as an email subscriber, but then they follow you on social media.
Yeah.
Keep the conversation going there. Offer that up as an option if you have an active social media presence.
Yeah, I think a lot of the takeaway is that afford people the opportunity to self-select the content that they want to see, so that you're sending them relevant offers and information and that sort of thing. In that way, they'll stay engaged.
Right.
So very important.
They started a relationship with you and they trusted you to send content that they find valuable. So don't change on that and start doing things differently. If you say you're going to send once a week, don't start sending every day, et cetera. Make sure you find out what your subscribers want. Let's look at JetBlue. This one is really well done. I love the Band-Aid, love the heart, I love the icons. They're playing with the idea of breaking up. They're asking people to choose how and when they'd like to be contacted. And be empathetic to their inbox and say, hey, we know you're probably getting a lot of emails and maybe we're sending too many to you. We want to change that. We want you to stay in the fold and just show that you are, as a marketer, understanding. You're just not trying to pump my inbox full of messages to read to try to sell me something. Once I worked with a company, they sold eyeglasses. And Ryan, I know you wear glasses, I do. How often do you buy frames?
Probably less frequently than I should.
Once a year, once every 2 years?
Probably, you know, once every few years, something. I mean, I have multiple pairs, but I just bought some recently, but I think it was about 3 years between.
All right. So if you were looking for a new set of glasses frames, and I told you about a website, you went there and you signed up for their newsletter, then every week they're just sending you an email trying to sell you frames. Would you open every single one of those emails?
No, particularly if I had already purchased some recently from them, and I would actually at that point get annoyed.
So that's what this client was actually doing. And what we ended up doing was putting more value into the emails. We would say, hey, here's how to care for your lenses. Here's how to organically improve your vision a little bit. And just some information around eyesight in general. And then every now and then we'd sprinkle in some specials, because maybe like me, maybe because I speak on stage sometimes, I don't want black or blue frames. Maybe I want hot pink so I stand out. So maybe around spring, I'll buy something that's a little bit more colorful. So maybe there's two opportunities a year, but what you want to do is send less frequently and then also have more value in your emails so people keep opening them.
Yeah, and if you have the purchase data, you have the tools necessary to do that.
Exactly.
To basically suppress people for an appropriate period of time. Same thing, you know, like cars, how often do you buy a car? You know, it's sort of a big ticket item. It's not purchased that often.
All right, let's look at Typeform. Here's another example that I liked. So basically what we're looking at here is the recipient noticed, telling the recipient you notice that they're not active, which is a common theme here, right? We're asking them direct questions, did you run out of ways to use Typeform? And that's an interesting question coming from a platform, right? And I love how they have one call to action to say, get inspired by our template gallery. And by doing that, it shows interest. So then you can know if they're interested in going back. And maybe you have tools in your product if you're a SaaS provider, and you can see if they're actually engaging with your platform. And then you know that they should stay in the fold. And just show them that you are interesting. We said that in the last slide. Just be human about this, folks, because emotions, I said it before, they go a long way. Treat them as such. Don't just say, we noticed you haven't opened our emails. Do you want to stay? Yes or no? That's kind of boring. And again, and subject lines, you know, Ryan mentioned using the subject line effectively. Use emojis in the subject line. This way you get more attention. All right, folks. So this is review and quiz time. I hope you've been taking notes. I hope you read some of the slides. I have a question here for you. I think I actually want to try out the poll section. Let's ask you guys, what percentage of your list will decay each year? Do you guys see that? Poll in progress for attendees, so I can actually run that that poll. All right, so 80% so far says 25%, 15% is at 19, and looks like we're gonna close this poll in about 3, 2, and 1. All right, so the answer was 25%, 74% of you said that, 21% of you said 15%, and then 5% said 10%. So awesome. Let's do, what percentage of folks that engage with your emails after a win-back campaign, how many of them continue to engage with further emails? Is it 60%, 45%, or 30%? Very attentive crowd today. 60%, 45%, and 30%. What percent of customers engage with more emails after a win-back campaign or successful win-back campaign? All right, I'm going to close in 3, 2, and 1. 35% of you said 60%, 50% said 45%, and 15% said 30%. And the answer is, it is 45%, so half of you got that right. And then last, this is more just in the question section, so these are the two that I just asked. Let's go with, if you're a campaign or customer, what is your favorite feature? So in the Q&A or the question section, let me know what your favorite feature is. And while you do that, we're going to move on and talk about the win-back timeline, which is what your takeaway is going to be here today. What do you need to do to run a successful win-back campaign? If you leave this webinar and Ryan and I did not do a great job of presenting so much great content, you should remember this. Identify your audience of subscribers that have not engaged with your email in a certain period of time, 6 months or a year, depending on how much you send. You want to automatically add them to a workflow, because by identifying the audience, you're going to put them in a segment, right? You're going to automatically add them to the workflow. You're going to send them a series of emails, 1, 2, or 3, or maybe more. I would say 3 should be the most. And then include emotion and maybe an incentive to win them back. And then what you want to do is, after that period of time, whether it's the 3 emails or 1 email, 1 and done, you're going to remove those non-reactive subscribers, rinse and repeat, because you could do what we're saying and do it once, but you want to make sure you're always doing this by using workflows. Or if you're doing it manually, you might have to do it every 3, 6, 9, or 12 months. It's something very important to do. And the biggest benefit I feel, Ryan, is better inbox deliverability. I don't know what your thought is. Maybe some marketers might say, hey, I can actually better measure my analytics because I'm getting rid of dead weight, therefore my open rate is actually true, right? It's my true open rate, where I feel like getting more emails to the inbox gives you more opportunity for a conversion. What are your thoughts?
I'm pretty much in agreement. If you're not inboxing, if you're not getting it in front of people, you know, you pretty much lost the battle right there. If they can't see you and react, well, you know, everything's important, but I think, you know, that's foremost, at least, you know, to my mind, is good inbox placement. You know, whether it's the promotional folder, the update folder, or the, you know, the personal inbox, if you're going to the spam folder, or worse, just being filtered out, you know, beforehand, it's you don't have a chance. At least if you're in the inbox, you have a chance.
Right. So it's important to run win back campaign, otherwise known as a re-engagement campaign, otherwise known as list hygiene, folks. No matter what you call it, they're all the same. They have the same results and they benefit you as a marketer. So what I want to do now is head into the ultimate Q&A, because we know there's a lot, always a lot of good questions. Go ahead, start typing those in the question box. We want to get to them. In the meantime, Sid said automation's his favorite feature. Killian said automation, and then Christy said segmentation and workflows. So we appreciate you letting us know about that. Always give us feedback on our product. We definitely want to hear about it so we can support you more and better. So let's go ahead. I think we actually answered that first question
here already. We've got one from Sid about the open rate, and you know, we sort of touched on earlier, but yeah, it is kind of situational depending on your industry. We do want to see around 10 to 15%, but you know, it is going to vary. Lloyd had a question. Would you recommend campaigns once a month? Again, situational, but I think one of the important things that often doesn't get touched on is that you want to be predictable in when you're sending. Big email client providers like Gmail don't like surprises, in the sense that, so if say, just I'll give you a hypothetical example. If you're sending on average, you know, 40,000 emails a month, and then all of a sudden you're sending 300,000, you're drawing all kinds of attention, because, you know, where did you get 260,000 contacts overnight? Usually the answer to that, you know, working in the industry, is somebody bought a list. And well, on Campaigner, that's forbidden, as well as most other reputable service providers. But above and beyond what we think, Gmail's gonna notice. They're gonna notice that your volume went through the roof overnight, and it's, you know, their AI is gonna pick up on it. And you know, it's hard to say exactly what they'll do, but you probably won't like it. So what you want to do is you know you want to have a consistent volume. So I mean, there's all kinds of legitimate ways that you can pick up additional contacts in bulk. I would say you'd want to phase them in. Just don't dump them all in at once. You know, drop them in. You know, break it up. You can do that in Campaigner via you know, put them in a list. You can shave off slices, so to speak, via static segmentation. But the main thing is, yeah, you want to see your volume increase gradually. And then at the same time, you know, it's going to depend on your content. But I would say, you know, usually you're going to send something like once a week. But I mean, that, you know, that may vary. But the thing is you want to be predictable and consistent. Nobody likes surprises, would be a takeaway from that.
All right. Yeah, and Lucas has a really awesome question here. What's the best way to send it? Do you want to continue to hear from us? You know, if a mass amount of people had unsubscribed from that list, wouldn't that hurt your reputation? Should there be a link to unsubscribe? That's a great question. It's not going to happen as much as you think. And you'd want people to unsubscribe rather than mark it as spam, even though unsubscribe is a negative factor. A spam complaint is worse. So you definitely don't want people to hit the spam button. That's why you don't want to keep sending emails to people that don't want it. But I would say, yeah, include a way to unsubscribe, almost like Chipotle did, right? They said, yes, they in, no, I want out. And that would be an unsubscribe link. But really what you're trying to do is get a certain amount of people back, right? Because 45% are going to continue to re-engage. But I think it's the average is about 10% is what you're going to get back from a re-engagement campaign. So only 10% of people are actually going to open and click that email. And I would say the percentage of people opening it and marking it as spam or unsubscribing is even lower than that. Therefore, the reputation to your domain is not going to be as bad as you think, but you definitely put an unsubscribe link in there if you want.
Yeah. And to add to that, I wouldn't even say that an unsubscribe is necessarily a bad thing. It's a legitimate tool. You know, in terms of allowing people to opt out of things, it's, I don't know that it necessarily is going to drag your sender reputation down. You know, maybe there's some kind of threshold, but I mean, it's a natural organic thing. People unsubscribe all the time. And I don't know that it's necessarily a black mark against your reputation in all instances. In my opinion, I think, you know, like we've been talking about, it's better to, you know, to let people go. And I think, you know, if you're displaying unsubscribes, you know, prominently, it is better than, as Hank said, than having a spam complaint. Spam complaint is a very, very bad thing. I mean, if you're on one of our shared pools, we pay very close attention to that. And then if you're garnering a lot of spam complaints, you know, you can't log. Well, an email client, is basically, the reaction is different, but, it's a defense mechanism, for their users, I guess you could say.
All right, so Sid says about 3 months ago, he imported a list from another provider. Should I wait in order to clean my list? Well, yeah, you want to have some history in there. I would say if it's 3 months, look at somebody who's been there for the 3 months and hasn't opened one email, especially if you sent once a week, and maybe start a campaign for those. And then over time, you can start weeding out some of the others. Also, there's a follow-up to that where, and this, I think you're talking about a different provider. Can I find inactive subscribers? We might not be able to help you with that. We could try our best. Maybe you can reach out to Ryan or myself, or we'll email you. But if it's in our platform, we could definitely help you out with that. It's usually just through segmentation. So Sid, we'll have to follow up with you on that. Lloyd said, should I be concerned with letting a subscriber know that I know that they haven't opened my emails? Ryan, what do you think about that?
I'm sorry, let me just read that again.
Should I be concerned with letting a subscriber know that I know that they haven't been opening their emails? I know what you did last summer.
Yeah.
Or didn't do.
I suppose it, it might look a little big brotherish, no, I don't think so. If you're sending them, enticing offer, something relevant and engaging, it's relatively normal these days. I wouldn't be too concerned about it now.
Yeah, no, I think actually some people will like the fact that you reached out to them to say, hey, do you want to stay with us? A lot of times I'll see some of those subject lines like, we miss you, we want you back. And I want to say, well, hopefully they are going to remove me because, I haven't been opening their emails and I'm watching what they're doing. So I applaud them as a marketer.
Yeah, if you're allowing people to select what you're sending them to, like in my case, the anecdotal evidence I gave before, I would be very happy about that, because I don't really want to unsubscribe from them, but they're driving me there at this point.
Right. Think about it. Most retailers know what you buy, and then they'll say in emails like, hey, you bought this, you bought pillows, do you need pillowcases? So people know they're being tracked. So I don't think it's such a shock to them to find out that, oh my God, they know I'm not opening their emails.
Yeah, it's pretty much the norm these days, I think.
Right. Sandra says she doesn't know how to identify those not opening emails, or segment them or put them into a workflow. I would say first and foremost, after this call, support can help you with this. If you have a client success manager, they're going to help you. Or if you have an account manager, they can help you as well. But basically, you just want to use the system, and there's filters. You go into segmentation and say, show me people who have not opened in the last X months, days, whatever.
I can give you some pretty quick instructions here. Is that basically, you would want to generate a segment. You're going to look for your segment based off of contact field, and then you're going to be looking at date last opened. And then there's the ability to specify, there's a lot of filters in there. We don't want to get into the weeds on it, but basically you're going to figure out, okay, how long, and then basically punch that into the segment. One other thing I would caution you about that I've seen people run into, though, is that, say hypothetically someone joined your list yesterday or, very relatively recently, and then you just do something like, it's very easy to figure out who hasn't opened anything ever, because then you would just look for a date last open is blank, indicating no data, no open. But if someone's joined recently and you don't specify that their date added to list was, say you're going on 6 months, that, if you don't specify, you would want to introduce additional filter to say that they were added at least 6 months ago, basically to protect you from eliminating someone added yesterday, because they haven't even had time to open, but they'll fit the criteria because they have no data.
All right, let's try to get through a couple of these because there's still a few more and we're almost at time. Carlos is asking, if my emails are being blocked by a spam filter, how will they get my win back email? Well, it's a catch 22. But what you're trying to do is get into the inbox or get people to open that actually are receiving them in the inbox, get them to engage so your domain reputation goes up and that more of your emails get into the inbox. That's the whole goal of it. And then hopefully, the more you improve your domain reputation, the more of those folks that were not getting your emails will start getting them. And then also by doing doing the list hygiene by saying, hey, this person received three emails, didn't open any of them. Could be because they're going to the spam folder. What you do want to do is remove them because that helps you. Once again, for new folks coming on, you don't want to punish the new folks that come onto your list by sending an email to their spam folder.
Yeah, potentially you might actually want to take remedial action in terms of trying to repair your domain reputation prior to cutting people loose. That might be the situation.
Right. All right, so another question, what's a good rule of thumb for subject lines? I think there's other webinars. We can do a whole nother webinar on subject lines, stuff like that. But like funny ones, it depends on your industry, serious ones, we miss you, question mark, emojis, that's good. If you want to reach out to us, we'll happily brainstorm with you. Chelsea says, going back to volume and sticking with consistent volume, what in general do SPs look at monthly volume? Well, they're looking at how many emails you're sending to each ESP, and more importantly, they're looking at what is the engagement, like Gmail. Hey, they're sending to 100 subscribers to us right now. How many of them are actively engaged? How many of them are not? You know, 40% are, 60% are not. You're not a viable sender. Let's send more of those to the spam folder. Yeah. So it doesn't necessarily mean if you send more, you're gonna get more into spam. It really just means what is your score now, and how are you massaging that score? And again, that's a whole different discussion. I would say talk to one of us in support or something.
I would say just in general is that they want to see the numbers increase organically. It's those huge shocks to the system. Like you had 40,000 contacts and then you have 200,000. Like if I was your client success rep and then you came to me and complained and then said, I'm getting poor results, I'm going to start going through your reporting and I'm going to look at it. And the first thing I'm going to notice is, well, you were sending this much. And then, you know, all of a sudden you're sending five times as much. I'm going to have some hard questions about where you got all of those contacts. Like if you had those, well, why did they appear all of a sudden? This is a very uncomfortable conversation to have, I assure you. But from the email client's perspective is that they're just going to cut you off at the knees. They're not going to want to debate about it. So, maybe those contacts are legitimate, but just phase them in over time. Like I have a very large account where something very similar to that happened, and it's all above board, no problems, but their clearinghouse was sitting on about 300,000 contacts. I've been phasing those in for almost 3 months now, to give you an idea.
We're going to continue to answer these last few questions. So if you have to leave, just hop on to YouTube in a couple of days. It will be there. We'll send it a link to, but it'll be there. You'll hear or see your name, because like Mark is asking, he's sending certain types of emails, right? How do you research what your domain reputation is? Now, if you're not using your own IP address, it's hard to measure what your credit score domain reputation is, because most providers, and we have as well, what's called a shared IP system. So in other words, it's not always coming from the same IP. So it's kind of hard to see what your own domain reputation is per se. Like if you have your credit score, right? What are the names of those Transamerica, whatever, and they all keep track. If you didn't have access to that, really, it's like, okay, are you paying your bills on time? You're paying your loans on time? Hey, if somebody's co-signed for a loan, did they pay on time? If you're doing the right things, your credit score is going to be good. So really what you want to look at is the percentage of people on each ISP that are opening, like Gmail. You want to have a good amount of people that over time, not saying they open every single email, but like say over the last 6 months, here are my 100 Gmail folks, what percentage of these people open 10 or more emails or whatever that is? And that kind of gives you an idea, plus the resource that Ryan mentioned, but I wouldn't take that to heart. If they say it's excellent, just say, well, maybe knock that down and say it's good.
Yeah, I wouldn't take that as gospel, but I mean, it'll give you an indication in any case. You can also look up there's organizations like Spam House and things like that. So you can find that kind of thing there. And then as well, if you're concerned, like I said, top domains, that's a fantastic report. I use it constantly. It gives you a good idea, what's happening. General internet in there actually subsumes all the smaller domains, like business type domains. There's just too many of them to list, so it aggregates them all together, but it gives you an idea of how you're performing there. You definitely want to look at those. It's sort of the canary in the coal mine. And at that point, you can reach out to your account manager, your client success rep, et cetera, for assistance, and potentially we can get the postmaster team involved. There's resources for sure.
Right. Chelsea's asking if my general month-to-month volume is about the same, including the win-back campaigns, but fluctuates weekly, would that still be okay? I mean, I get the question, but really what you want to just make sure is, you know, are your subscribers going to not like the amount of emails they're getting from you? And just make sure that you're, you know, if you're selling one product that somebody doesn't buy too often, you don't want to send every day. You don't want to maybe even send every week. Maybe it's once a month. Like for me, I have a personal journal that I send out about tools, tips, and books that I've read. I send it once a month. And it's kind of a recap of the previous month. I would not want to send out a weekly one unless I had a lot more marketing tips and ideas. So it just depends on your content, depends on your industry. And again, we mentioned a few times asking your subscribers what they want. Use a survey. I mean, that's the best way to do that. All right. Tom says, does this apply to phone calls? I combined emails with scheduled phone follow-up. See, that's great for sales. Like you can see if somebody is like interested and you call them because they open, or they're not interested, you follow up and you get them on the phone and you close a deal. But the ESPs don't care whether or not you had a phone call with them. They want to know if somebody actually opened and clicked and engaged with your email. So I would say phone reach outs and email are separate entities. When it comes to sales, they go hand in hand. But when it comes to marketing or measuring and analytics, they're different. And Sid said, so do we have client success reps? We do. You know, certain plans afford you a client success rep or an account manager. So you could definitely inquire about that. We would work with you on strategy, ideas, how to use the platform more effectively, send you cool puppy pictures. Well, maybe not the last item, but we definitely want to help you out as much as possible.
Yeah, training, general knowledge, support, that sort of thing.
Well, with that, you know, Ryan, myself, and my cat Tigger, thank you for being here today. We definitely enjoyed sharing how to run a win-back campaign or what you should call it, how often you should send emails, how to look at your domain reputation, and most importantly, how to help you get more out of your email marketing campaigns. Ryan, it was a pleasure having you on this webinar today, and I feel like we need to do another one probably around subject lines soon.
Sounds good. Thanks for having me, Hank. Appreciate it.
All right. And we're getting a lot of great feedback. So thank you, everybody, for being here today. Catch the recap on YouTube in a few days and keep an eye out for future webinars and hope to see you there. Thank you, everybody.
Have a good day, everyone. Bye-bye.